Welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Dr. N. Shivasenani. I have done PhD in Sanskrit studies from University of Hyderabad. Today, in the paper Vedic Epic and Puranic Culture of India, we deal with the module Natya Shastra. The objectives of this module are that we should get an introduction to Natya Shastra, who the author is, what the subject matter is, what is the time of the text, then learn a bit about the rasa theory, which is the most important contribution of Natya Shastra, the 10 types of plays, the 4 types of acting, get some familiarity with the music and instruments described in Natya Shastra, so that we can conclude with an estimate of the cultural development at the time of Natya Shastra in India. What is Natya Shastra? It's an encyclopedia of drama. It has been composed by sage Bharata. Scholars differ as to what exactly is the date. These vary between 3rd century BC and 1st century AD. Traditionally, it is believed that Brahma taught the subject to Bharata Muni, and Bharata Muni propagated the same. There are mainly verses here. Occasionally, prose is also available in the particular text. This has 36 chapters and divided into 6,000 verses. The subjects covered are origin of Natya, rasa theory, 10 types of play, the various aspects of acting, music, types of characters, distribution of roles, etc. As I said, it's a encyclopedia of dramaturgy and covers pretty much everything related to staging a drama. Why should we spend time on this particular text? If you want to understand the culture of ancient India, dance, music and drama, they form a very important part of any culture. And Natya Shastra is a compendium of dance, music and drama. What is interesting is that it goes beyond a description of these and actually gives a theory of this, showing that arts had reached a very high state of sophistication in ancient India. And we also see that there is continuity in most of these elements is seen to this date. All of you are aware of the swaras, sa, ri, ga, ma, pa, da, ni. These are mentioned in the Natya Shastra. So the music we have today, the building blocks, has been there for at least 2000 years. Similarly, the kind of mudras we see in traditional dance, they have been described in great detail in Natya Shastra. The structure of plays, including the way movies start in India, current India, they draw from the theory prescribed in Natya Shastra. Finally, the theory of rasa, it had the highest influence on all Indian literature, including films as it were. So this is the reason why we should know a bit more about Natya Shastra, because our contemporary culture is a continuation of that. And if you want to know the culture in ancient India, there is no better source than Natya Shastra. Amongst the various topics, the most important one is rasa. In the rasa theory, the following questions are answered. What is rasa? How does rasa nishpati happen? How does rasa emerge? What are bhavas? What are the various types of rasas? And the most complicated topic called universalization or generalization. That's a difficult one, but let us make an attempt there. Let's start with what rasa is. The question is, why is literature appreciated? Literature means both the books as well as dramas and films. We call them drishyakavyas and shravyakavyas, those that are to be heard, those that are to be seen. Right? Films and dramas are those that are seen, and books are those that are read or heard. So throughout the discussion, remember this, literature includes films. Why is literature appreciated? Because of rasa svadana, because we relish the rasa. And what is rasa? Originally, rasa means sap or juice. Therefore, it came to mean senses like flavor, essence, etc. So what is this taste of literature? That's what rasa would be then. Some call it sentiment, others call it aesthetic experience. We'll occasionally refer to as aesthetic relish, but some words are better not translated. We'll stick with rasa throughout this. The thesis of Natyashastra is that any literature, poetry, prose or drama is good if it results in rasasvadana, experience of the aesthetic relish. Films are considered as literature in this framework, as I said. In fact, from a rasa point of view, films and drama are more amenable to the production of rasa. You will see it as we go forward. So, there is something called a Rasa Sutra in Natyashastra. This is the most famous statement. Vibhava anubhava vibhichari samyogat rasa nishpattihi. Nishpatti means production or coming out. Rasa is produced when vibhava, anubhava and vibhichari bhava come together. Let us see what these three bhavas are. There are varying theories on how exactly these come together and the process through which rasa is produced. We'll offer a very simple explanation first, then go to the more complicated one. Just consider the scenario where India wins a match, any match. It could be a football match, it could be a cricket match, it could be PV Sindhu winning a match, anything. What do we see? First, that spectators are happy. Then what do they do when India wins the match or Sindhu wins the match? They clap, shout and jump with joy. They feel an adrenaline rush. Whatever adrenaline rush that they have, it results that even after a while, they keep doing this energetic things. It does not immediately come down. So, if we analyze this kind of thing, this is common experience. With slight variations, the same thing happens. Some people throw bottles, some other people throw posters. But let us say they're all energetic. That's common experience. Now, let us analyze this. What is the first step? The first is that India wins a match. This is the reason. Second step is that spectators immediately clap in joy. That is an almost involuntary reaction. Third, which is a deliberate one, lasts for a time, which is that they are in a state of high energy. They do hi-fis, they jump, shout, etc. during this particular period. Now, if this much is clear, rasa becomes very clear now. The first is called vibhava. That is, India winning the match is the reason for the joy of spectators. When the winning stroke is made, when the winning when the win happens, spectators are happy but still not brimming with energy. Second one is that they start clapping. This is the expression of their happiness. It is involuntary. It's not intentional at all. The moment the ball crosses the boundary, the moment the cock, dies, the clapping will start. Third one is the behavior, deliberate behavior of spectators, which is called the vyabhichari bhava. The first one is vibhava, second one is anubhava, third one is the vyabhichari bhava. That means the reason for winning, that is the vibhava. The immediate involuntary reaction, that is the anubhava, what happens after that. And the demonstration of the particular state of mind, of utsaha, that is the vyabhichari bhava or sanchari bhava, both are used. The last one is called the permanent mood or sthayi bhava of utsaha. This stays for a while, and once the vyabhichari bhava transforms into a sthayi bhava and that stays for a while, that is when we say that the rasa is experienced. What is this rasa? It is the veera rasa, right? There is a victor amongst our country, our country has won, our countrymen have won, or the girl from our country has won, whichever way we look at it. So, this permanent mood of utsaha, energy is what leads the aswadana of the rasa called veera rasa. This much is simple, I hope. Now, let us take a more complicated example. Before we do that, what are all the rasas? Some people say there are 8. Bharata said there are 8. Many people hold them to be 9. Navarasas is also equally popular. But if you stick to the text of Natyashastra, 8 are mentioned. In the commentary of Abhinav Gupta, he says he has seen a version where the 9th rasa Shanta is also mentioned. But the main 8 rasas are Shrungara Hasya Karunaha, Raudra Veera Bhayanakaha, Bibhatsadbhuta Saunyo Chet Ashtau Rasasmrutaha. The first rasa is Shrungara. By the way, in all our ancient texts, the order is equally important. These are dealt with in this order everywhere. First is Shrungara, that is romance, Hasya, humor, Karuna, pathos, Raudra, fury, Veera, heroism, Bhayanaka, fear or terror, Bibhatsa, disgust or abhorrence, Adbhuta, wonder. Some of the English terms may change, But let us stick to the Sanskrit terms, Srungara, Hasya, etc. For each of these eight rasas, there are eight sthayi bhavas, the permanent mood. For example, Veera, we saw that there was Utsaha as the sthayi bhava. What are the various sthayi bhavas? For Srungara, it is Rati. Rati is love. Hasya, Hasi is the sthayi bhava. Hasi is laughter. In Karuna, for Karuna rasa, the sthayi bhava has to be Shoka. Only when there is Shoka, you will find there is Karuna happening. Karuna rasa swadana will happen. For Raudra, the sthayi bhava is Krodha, anger. For Veera, the sthayi bhava is Utsaha. Only when Utsaha lasts for a while, then the rasaswadana of Veera rasa happens. For Bhayanaka, the sthayi bhava is Bhaya or fear. For Bibhatsa, the sthayi bhava is Jugupsa, abhorrence. We cannot just stand it. For Adbhuta, the fantastic rasa, the sthayi bhava is Vismaya, wonder. We should be left wondering. It's like, you know, when Hanuman crosses Lanka, we have this feeling. Or crosses the ocean to go to Lanka. The various vibhavas for Shrungara are listed, etc. For example, the season, flowers, ornaments, anything beautiful, all these are called the vibhavas for Shrungara. That means when there is a depiction in the book or in the film or in drama of very beautiful things, it causes the emergence of, it is the reason why the other things happen, which ultimately culminate in Shrungara Rasaswadana. What are the anubhavas? Looking sideways, coy glances, sweet words of the heroines, etc. What is the sanchari bhava? Lassitude, one gets tired, suspicion, jealousy, all these indicate that there is Shrungara. Therefore, when Satyabhama is jealous about other wives dealing with Krishna, what we see is that it is the sanchari bhava before Shrungara bhava emerges. Similarly, all these are listed. You can go through them in the learning material or in the slide itself. We will not go through it right now. But for know this, that in Natashastra, for each rasa, all the sthayi bhavas, etc. are also listed. Apart from sthayi bhavas, the vyabhichari bhava, the anubhava and vibhava are also listed. So much for the simple theory of rasa. I call this simple because this does not explain many things. For example, I'll just give one question. All of us want to be happy. Am I wrong? I mean, right? All of us want to be happy. Everybody agrees, right? Then why do we watch a movie or read a book where Karuna Rasa is there? After all, Karuna Rasa is the sthayi bhava Shoka, right? We feel bad. Why do we watch tragedies? If we want to be happy, we should avoid tragedies, right? But writers are writing tragedies, people are looking and reading tragedies. There is a tragic element in films. In fact, Bhavabhuti says Karuna is the only rasa. So what is this strange thing that human beings want to be happy, but they spend their time reading or watching something where there's a lot of sorrow? How do we explain it? If we ask questions like this, we realize that the simple theory of rasa is not sufficient. So the way mind works in relishing this has been explained as the generalization theory. This is a culmination of many things. This theory resulted from an intense analysis of how exactly rasa comes into being and is experienced. Speculations relating to rasa nishpati happened for almost 1,000 years that we know of. It might have happened for longer before this theory got established. This is one major contribution of ancient India to the modern appreciation of poetry. Elsewhere, people are still figuring out what exactly is the atma of poetry. Why is poetry relished? They are figuring out. In India, we have kind of figured out around 1,000 years ago. Let us see what that is. To just walk you through, there are various views about emergence of rasa. One says that sthayi is developed by the contact, determinants, etc. Just like explained. Then in its developed state, sthayi only becomes rasa. That sthayi resides in the historical characters like Rama, etc. But it is seen in the actor on account of his being identified with Rama. For example, you've seen the Ramayana serial on TV, maybe the character who plays Rama. We see the sthayi in him, not the historical Rama. Sthayi is inferred by signs such as determinants, consequence, etc., vibhava, anubhava, etc. In its developed state, it becomes rasa. There are various theories like this. They are all presented here. We'll just go through them without spending time. Another theory is like this, that it is a wall painting. There are various colors, but together they show you that it's a horse. right? Yet another theory says that rasa can be directly expressed but not perceived. It cannot be produced or inferred. It's only enjoyed. We'll go to the theory of Abhinavagupta, whose exposition now is the mainstream view. He says, kavyarthan bhavayanti iti bhavaha. What are bhavas? They bring out the meaning of poetry. Bhavas, the mental states, are those that bring the meaning of poetry, that is rasa, into existence. He says there are basic mental states and transient emotions. These bring forth the various rasas. The basic mental states and transient emotions are already known to the spectator. They are called vasana. The poetry or drama generalizes these mental states and transient emotions, which leads the spectator to experience them at the aesthetic level. That is, the shoka of Sita becomes a shoka of everybody. Let's see how this works. Let us take an example. For example, consider this sentence: Samba prayed to the sun god and became free from disease. Somebody says that there's a historical character called Samba who had a disease, who prayed to sun god, became free of disease. First, we understand the meaning of this sentence. That is called the vachyartha, or the direct sense. Second, our mind starts working. An additional meaning is discerned. Oh, it's not only Samba, but whoever prays to sun will become free of diseases. Adityat arogyam ichet, the going says. So everybody says that if you pray to sun, you get good health. Then in step two, we also generalize it, that prayer to sun will result in good health. This is true at all times. This is true at all places. Then we get the feeling, hey, you know what? I also have this niggling problem. Let me pray to sun. Let me do Aditya Hridayam every day. This feeling automatically comes in the people of who listen to the sentence, Samba prayed to the sun god and became free from disease. This is how the mind works. Now, the first stage, this is three-stage process. The first stage is the cognition concerning an individual. Second stage is generalized cognition, saying that it's not only Samba, but anybody who prays to sun will also be free of disease. In stage three, the listener or the spectator starts participating. Even I want to pray to sun and become free of the disease. In fact, this is how all the fraudsters cheat people. But let us take a more better example. We'll take an example from Veda called Swarga Kamo Yajeta. One desirous of attaining heaven may perform a sacrifice. If you want to go to heaven, perform a sacrifice. This motivates the one who reads a sentence to perform a yajna. This is called bhavana or vidhi or niyoga, etc. in Mimamsa. And then it is generalized. Therefore, when Veda simply says, you perform a yajna, you go to Swarga, people take it as true and then do that. This is called Samanyi Karana in Alankara Shastra. It never said that you perform, you go, that is the meaning, of course, but people understand that if I perform a yajna, I also will go to Samanyi Karana. We'll take an example from Kalidasa's play Abhijnana Shakuntalam, where Dushyanta is chasing a deer. Kalidasa, the poet, wonderfully describes the feeling of fear in the deer, which is being hunted by Dushyanta. I'll read the English translation, my own. Flinging a glance over and anon at the pursuing chariot, in a way graceful on account of the bending of his neck, having the major portion of his hinder part entered the fore part of his body through the fear of the descent of an arrow, and strewing his path with half-chewed darbha grass, dropping from his mouth, gaping through exhaustion. Behold how he, on account of his lofty leaps, traverses more through the sky and less on the ground. Basically, the poet is describing the state of the, it is called a Swabhavakti Alankara, of the deer, wherein it is not even eating. It was eating, it started leaping, and its leaps are so long that it is more in the sky than in earth. It is bending back and checking where Dushyanta is when he will release his arrow. When we read this particular poem, first the sense is understood, then the limitations are removed. We start forgetting that it is one deer which is afraid. We see the universal feeling of fear. The young deer is no longer a participant, the particular one being chased, it is any frightened deer. Then only a frightened state of mind is perceived. This fear is not related to anyone in particular. Every eligible spectator gets the same generalized mental state. All of us then experience this fear of the deer. That is how poetry works. This is when we say that the rasaswadana happens. You can see various examples also. In a room, your just friends are talking, suddenly somebody starts shouting. People say atmosphere has become tense, because whatever is the spirit or the disagreement between two people, it kind of now passes to everybody. If somebody shouts at his servant, his guests are also kind of annoyed, because once krodha has been expressed, it takes some time for all minds to readjust. This is how samanyikarana of these bhavas happen. And when we start relishing rasa, the enjoyment is not in the particular sentiment or the particular emotion, but the very fact that you enjoy this rasa is what makes it enjoyable. That's the reason why even though there is shoka happening, you still enjoy it, because you forget yourself. You become united with the cosmic consciousness. That is the reason why Anubhava Gupta says that this is very close to understanding Brahman himself. Later Vishwanatha says, rasa swadana is Brahmananda Sahodari. If we can completely immerse ourselves in a movie, in a book, we forget ourselves, then we reach a higher state of consciousness. That is the reason why it does not matter whether it is sorrow or laughter. If we can forget our present troubles and relish it, it's a great experience. This is a secret of a great poetry, great films being enjoyed. There are certain impediments identified by Anubhava Gupta. Why doesn't it happen? I write a book, no, people don't get the same feeling. Because there are some obstacles. What are these obstacles? First, the impossibility of the presented. Whatever we present must be understandable to the spectators, otherwise they can't reach it. Second one, subjective and objective limitations of time and space. If there are certain defects related to the reader, some people have a negative mind. Oh, how can Bahubali movie, that fellow do that and this is not possible. You think like that, you will never get to rasa. It's that simple. You need to let go of yourself and get immersed. So there could be a defect related to the reader. You should approach poetry as if poetic incidents concern them. They should not take them literally. These defects will stop rasaswadana. There is influence of personal joys and sorrows. If the mind of the reader is preoccupied with his own earlier things, he will not enjoy that particular thing, book or movie. This is the reason why before dramas, there is decoration of theatres, there are introductory songs and dances. All these are designed to kind of calm down the spectator, so that ahrudaya is converted into a sahrudaya. Now he should forget his individual troubles and immerse himself in the movie. This is what a lot of dramas do. Even modern films follow this technique to a certain extent. Sometimes there is lack of clarity. This also is a defect. When there is subordination of the principal theme, this is an author's defect. If there is, if the spectators cannot relate to the presentation because of lack of obviousness, that is, if insufficient determinants, insufficient vibhavas are there. I mean, if the heroine or hero is falling in love, enough material must be there in the movie for the spectator to understand. This or the combination of these defects will lead to non-relishment of rasa. But if none of these defects are there, that particular kavya will result in rasa swadana. This then is the biggest contribution of Natya Shastra. We look at other topics now. It also covers 10 types of plays. Not many are aware of this. 10 types of plays are listed. Nataka is only one of them, the popular one. The others are Prakarana, Anka, Vyayoga, Bhana, Samavakara, Vithi, Prahasana, Dima, Ihamruga. We have examples of various of these kind of plays in Sanskrit literature, but not all of them are popular. There are detailed descriptions and qualities are given. For example, a Nataka must have 7 to 10 acts, whereas a Prakarana can have only 5 to 10 acts. Others mostly are single act plays, but Samavakara, Dima and Ihamruga are exceptions with 3 and 4 acts. Then in each one of them, the story should be well known, or a story of fiction that is conceived by the author himself. These rules are laid down. The kind of rasa suitable for each one of these formats is given. The hero is given. In fact, Natya Shastra is very detailed. The devata for rasa is given. The color is given, etc. This is not the place or time where we get into all this, but know that there are 10 types of plays described in the Natya Shastra. In Indian tradition, plays are of 10 types. Now we'll come to acting proper. There are four components of acting: Angika, Vachika, Aharya, and Satvika. Angika means relating to Angas. Anga means limbs. Vachika is relating to Vak, that is to speech. This is acting through speech. Aharya means your costume or your makeup, your dress. So acting through costume, makeup, jewelry, etc. is called Aharya Abhinaya. Satvika is when the actor immerses himself in the character so much that he starts behaving like the character only. Then that is called Satvika acting. For example, somebody is acting as Rama. He becomes so dharmic that his smallest movement is as if Rama himself is doing it. See, they say this about old actors. In erstwhile AP, Mr. N.T. Rama Rao used to be revered as a great actor, especially his characters of Rama, Krishna used to be very great. So they say that when he was acting as Rama, he used to eat only vegetarian food. He wanted to get the sattva guna in him come to the fore, because Rama is an enlightened soul. He was always so ever gentle, though he was a great hero. So in order to get this sattva guna out of him, N.T. Rama Rao apparently stopped all kinds of food which is not amenable to this particular guna. So when somebody immerses into a role like that, that's when we get the Satvika Abhinaya. These four are not independent but are interrelated. In fact, Natyashastra is organized around these particular four. For example, let us just take Angika Abhinaya. Bodily action is there. How many body parts are there? There are 6 body parts: head, hands, chest, sides, waist, and feet. Within heads, what are there? Eyes, eyebrows, nose, lower lip, cheeks, chin. Within eyes, there are 36 types of glances listed there. Hands, various mudras, asamyuta hasta mudras, samyuta hasta mudras, etc. Then there are chari, which is gestures of feet, calf muscles, etc. Mandala is movement achieved by number of charis. If you just look at it, it's such an encyclopedic treatment. I mean, you list eyes as one of the angika components, and you list 36 glances of using eyes. That's why it's called a manual of acting. Similarly, if you look at Vachika Abhinaya, first the languages to be used are determined. Sanskrit is used for lofty characters like king, minister, queen, and courtesan in certain scenes. These people can also sometimes resort to Prakrit. Various Prakrits are listed: Magadhi, Avanti, Avanti, Prachya, Saurasheni, Ardha Magadhi, Bahlika, and Dakshinatya. In some cases, we have Shakara Bhasha and the languages of Abhiras, Chandalas, Shabaras, Dramilas, Andhras, etc. All these are names of Prakrit, and the number of characters you speaking Prakrit is always more than the number of characters speaking Sanskrit. And various ways of speech are also covered there, which we are not covering in this, just giving a glimpse of it. Again, in Aharya, various ornaments, clothes, weapons, hairdos are described. In fact, there is a code. For example, if somebody has a black Angavastra, he should be recognized as Balarama. Like that, the color of the cloth. You also know that anybody with a blue body color is Rama or Krishna, etc. Like that, there are certain agreed notations or conventions about who wears what. Now, Satvika Abhinaya cannot be perceived directly. The actor is feeling like the character, right? So it is always combined with Angika and Vachika modes of acting. You know, the greatest Satvika Abhinaya, what happens? When people can have tears without using glycerin, when people can have sweat without in a cold place, that is when Satvika Abhinaya is at its best. This is connected to by the spectator on his own. So Natyashastra describes this four in great detail. After acting, it deals with music and musical instruments. This is called Gandharva Vidya. There are 3 components there: Swara, Tala, and Pada. The 7 notes, Shajja, Rishabha, Gandhara, Madhyama, Panchama, Dhaivata, and Nishada, that is Sarigama, Padani, are described here. And they are described in, you know, you might wonder, how do you give the pitch of Sa? It has to be taught. Oh, they say that, you know, the way a peacock makes sounds, that is in Shajjama, right? Like that, for each one of them, an animal sound is given an example, so that even without producing the sound, through a book also, the nature of sound can be transmitted to us. Then suitability of music for delineation of different bhavas is set out. You must be wondering why we have so much of background score, why music is such a big component of Indian films, why we have songs and dances in Indian films, because we have a tradition of Natyashastra. In Natyashastra, the expression of bhavas is through music as well. So for each time of the day, for each bhava, the relevant ragas, the relevant music has been given here. The tradition is still followed. In terms of musical instruments, four types of musical instruments are described. One is tatam, which is a stringed instrument like veena, etc. Another one is avanadham, which is struck like a mrudangam. The third one is ghanam, which is made of bronze, etc., like bell, so that it makes a ringing sound. The final one is sushiram, like flute, etc., venu, which is wherein air is blown through holes at a separate distance. So we see that in ancient India, music was at a very developed state, and the four main kinds of musical instruments were there. A detailed manual of drama and dance is available. In terms of acting, the kind of detail that Natyashastra says, I suspect whether any modern book also has. From this, we can arrive at an estimate of the state of culture or music, dance and drama in ancient India. We see that Natyashastra is a comprehensive text of dramaturgy. That means drama was in a very advanced state. In fact, there is evidence available that there were earlier Natasutras. Bharata was only one of the proponents of Natyashastra. His book is called Natyashastra, but there are other authors of Natasutras. There is a tradition of Natasutras happening, and since Natyashastra is one of the best, not one of, it is the best, it survived for us for 2000 years and more later. The amount of detail, as I said, is amazing, which will not be found in a modern text on a manual of acting. I don't know if all these film development institutes also have these detailed, a book of acting which is so detailed on what are the 36 types of eye glances. We also see that there is continuity in essential aspects to present date, whether it is dance, what you call Bharatanatyam, whether it is the various mudras that are used in various dances across India. Not only in Bharatanatyam, but in other dances as well, like Kuchipudi or Odissi, Manipuri, etc., we see connectivity from Bharata's Natyashastra. We see connectivity in music. We see connectivity in the continuity in the musical instruments. That means the kind of music and dance and drama that we are exposed to today is at least in some ways similar to what was obtained earlier. So if you want to know the culture of India 2000 years back, it was not very different from what we have today. I told you in the beginning that a lot of films follow it. Most films have Ishtadeva Prarthana in the beginning. That is also an old poetic tradition. That all works start with prayer to God or prayer to one's guru. This is still followed to this day. Such has been the continuity of culture in India. The richness of detail shows that these were very highly evolved at the time of Natyashastra. They are not, you know, crude forms. In fact, not only were these art forms evolved, there was a very sound theory of aesthetics which is well developed. I mean, people are still struggling in critical theory and theory, it is called in English, appreciation of poetry. There is Russian formalism, etc. as to what makes poetry click, what is that which makes a film great. And here is this theory which was developed 2000 years ago, discussed for 1000 years. Which says, I'll tell you why you feel happy when you see a tragedy. A very detailed theory is available. That we had a theory of art, we had a theory of relishment, shows that at least in these art forms, India was very, very advanced even by the time of Natyashastra. That can only say that the civilization itself was very sophisticated. Thank you.